Have you ever thought about what if there is no heaven? Really, what would life be all about? Where would we escape the sickness and the suffering and the pain and all the things that we deal with in this world? Well, the reason that heaven is such a great place is because we look forward to something better than what's here on earth. My name is Josh McCrary. I'm the preacher for the Ripley Church of Christ in Ripley, Mississippi. And I hope that you'll stay tuned today as we talk about the rest that is set before us and how we long to go to heaven when we meet God to be with Him in eternity.
The law of thy mouth is better unto me than thousands of gold and silver. And now, Josh McCrary, the gospel is gold.
There was a son who asked his dad, he said, Dad, why did God make my wife so beautiful, so kind, and such a good cook? Well, his father answered and said, well, son, that's easy, so that you could love her. So the son asked his dad, he said, well, Dad, tell me, why did God make her so ignorant sometimes? And the dad said, well, son, that's easy too. That's so that she could love you. You know, when you think about it, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out the plain message of the Bible. Now, there are some difficult things in the scriptures, but to get the overall theme, I mean, really, you can either serve God and go to heaven and rest forever, or you can serve the devil and go to hell and have no rest forever. We began a three-part series of things set before us, and in this last part of this series, we're going to talk about the rest that is set before us. I want us to begin in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 4, when God describes how that the church of our Lord will meet the Lord forever. And it says that she is like a bride adorned for her husband. And the Bible says that God will wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there'll be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, and neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. You think about what rest heaven will be like and how great and wonderful it will be. One of the main reasons why it will be so wonderful is because we will escape the sickness and the death and the sorrow of this world. But you think about a person who does not obey the gospel. What will eternity be like for that person? Well, the Bible describes this in Revelation chapter 14, beginning in verse 10, and he said, "The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, in his in the cup of his indignation, and they will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of his holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." So you compare the life of eternity that people have when they serve God as opposed to those who do not. And he says, these people, they have no rest. You know, heaven is so great because people will rest forever. I think of a passage right now. It says, "Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and the works do follow them." I want to share with you a poem before we continue to our next passage here. And the poem says, "Lord, I know this life is a test to see whether we will search for eternal rest. So help me, Lord, to seek things above and to offer you my life and my love. I vow to serve you every day and to lead others in the way. I pray I'll keep your commands and obey when no one else understands. I know by your grace the test will score me, and by his blood I will find the rest set before me." I want to ask you today, friend, are you covered in the blood of Christ? I pray that you are. And I hope today that when you think about serving God in this life, that you will look forward to that rest that is set before us. I want to read our text. It's from Revelation chapter 14, verses 12 and 13. And I want to give you 5 points from these passages here. And I hope that you'll try to rivet these points on your heart and your life so that you can look forward to that home in heaven. The Bible says, "Here is the patience of the saints, and here are they which keep the commands of God, and the faith of Jesus Christ. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them." I want to talk about the patience. I want to talk about the promise and the place and the peace and the performance. And these 5 things are found right here in Revelation chapter 14, verses 12 and 13, which is our text, talking about the rest set before us. Number one, let's talk about the patience. He said, here are the patience of the saints. What does that mean? Today in society, we think of patience and we think, well, that person gets on my nerves, so I have to have patience with them. Or maybe my children are being disobedient, so I have to be patient with them. Well, it's similar, but the idea here, when he says, here are the patience of the saints, it literally means to endure or endurance. It's like running a race and you feel like you want to quit because your legs get tired. Well, in this instance, the word patience would be correct to say, I need to have the patience to finish that race. It's like enduring. So here's what he's saying. Here is the endurance of the saints and those who keep the commands of God. You know, I think about it this way, and I'm reminded of someone who said, Dad, where did I get my intelligence from? And Dad answered his son, and he said, you must have gotten it from your mother because somehow I managed to keep all of mine. Well, you know, I tell you, women are very smart in many areas, much smarter than men sometimes. But I will tell you this, friend, sometimes living together with family takes patience. Sometimes being in a marriage takes patience. Dealing with children takes patience. And being a Christian takes patience too. You know, you have to have endurance. I want to give you several different translations that use the same passage here. It says, here are the perseverance of the saints which keep the commands of God. That's one. Another one says, this calls for patient endurance on the part of the saints who obey the commands of God. You have another translation that says, God's people must learn to endure and they must also obey His commands. So you can see the idea there is really about endurance. I want you to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 1 if you have your Bibles and invite your attention there. And I want to just share with you this word patience and the idea of it. If you look at it in the original language, it's a combination of two words and it literally means an underdwelling or to dwell under. It is a combination of a preposition and a noun and it's under and dwelling. So here's what he says. Here is the patience of the saints. Here is the underdwelling of the saints, those who keep the commands of God. So picture this. You have a man who literally makes his dwelling under the commands of God. I want to ask you today, friend, is that you? Are you a person who has made your dwelling under the commands of God? You say, Lord, I will do anything that you want for me to do. Then I have to make my dwelling under God's will. That's the idea here. And those who have rest for all eternity are those who have literally endured unto the end and have kept the commands of our Lord. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul is writing about his great persecution that he experienced. And he uses this word endure. He said, I endured through it. And you look here and he says, whether we be afflicted is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same suffering which we also suffer. So he said, if we've been afflicted, it's for you. We did that for you. We endured that so that you could remain faithful to God and so that we could remain faithful to God as well. Number two, not only do I see the patience of the saints, but I see the promise of the saints because he said, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. He also said that they may rest from their labors. So you see the idea then. The promise is that they are blessed for all eternity and they will rest for all eternity. I'm reminded of a husband who took his wife on their 10th anniversary trip. He took her to an African safari. And at any rate, he was telling his friend about it. He said, you know, I took my wife on an African safari for our 10th anniversary. And his friend said, well, man, you know, you set the bar high. What are you going to do for your 20th anniversary? The man said, well, I guess I'll go back and pick her up. Well, you know, when you think about a vow that you make in marriage, you vow never, ever to leave or forsake that person. You think about the vow that you make to God. You say, when you obey the gospel, Lord, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. You think about the vow that God made to you. God also has promised this in multiple places in the Bible. I think of Hebrews 13 right now, in verse 6. He says, He has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So God made a promise to you, and He will never leave you. The question you have to ask yourself, and I have to ask myself, is, have I remained faithful to my promise? God makes a promise, He'll keep it. He said, you all are blessed if you die in the Lord. You will rest from your labors if you die in the Lord. But have I kept my promise? You know, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 1, let us therefore fear lest the promise of being left us of entering into His rest, that any of us should seem to come short of it. Basically, God has promised it and it will always stay there. And if anyone breaks their promise, it would be us. So He says, let us fear lest the promise being left us to enter into His rest, lest we fall short of it. We've got to keep on going unless we fall short of His promise. You know, you move down further in the chapter in verse 9 of Hebrews 4. And He said, therefore there remaineth a rest unto the people of God. For he that hath rest from his labors, he hath ceased from his works as God did from his. So yes, the promise is there. And the Bible calls it an eternal rest. I want to share with you something that was made known by Abraham Lincoln in 1863 when he gave a speech to the United States. Now, I want you to think about the difference of today. He says, we've been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We've been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity, and we have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever grown. He said, we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And as we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all the blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming, preserving grace. Too proud to pray to God that made us. So interesting to see what he said in 1863 and compare it to what we had. Abraham Lincoln said that they were too successful during that time. They had forgotten God. And you think about all the things that we have today. I want to ask you, friend, do you look forward to that promise to be with God, or have the things of the world, gotten you down and taken away your promise? Joshua chapter 1, God promised Joshua and said, there shall not a man stand before thee of all of your enemies. As I was with Moses, I will also be with you. I will not fail you nor forsake you. You know, you think about the promise given to Israel in Joshua chapter 21 and verse 43, which says, the Lord gave unto Israel all the land which He sware unto their fathers. They possessed it and dwelt therein. And the Lord gave them rest round about according to all that He sware unto their fathers. And there stood not a man of all their enemies before them. You think about what God promised to the people of Israel, and He fulfilled it word for word. He told them, I will give you rest. And in Joshua 21 and verse 43, He says that's exactly what happened. He gave them rest according to all that He sware unto their fathers. So if God promised them rest to go into the land of Canaan, why would He forsake His promise of your land of Canaan today when you get to heaven? Friend, God made a promise, but you have to have patience. You have to endure. Number three, not only do I see the patience of the saints, I see the promise of the saints, but I also see the place of the saints. Because in your text, He said, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. That means you have to be in Christ. Friend, you can't go to heaven outside of Christ. You know what that means? You can't go to heaven outside of the body of Christ, the church. So many people today believe that you could just go to heaven any old way that you want to. But the truth is, in Ephesians 3 and verse 11, the Bible calls the church God's eternal purpose. In Acts 20 and verse 28, Jesus purchased the church with His blood. In Ephesians 5:23, it says he's the Savior of the body. So you think about the importance of the church today. You cannot go to heaven outside of Christ. That's what he means when he said, blessed are they who die in the Lord. You have to be in the body of Christ. That's where you contact his blood. John was born in 1917 in Brookline, Massachusetts. He attended school at Harvard University. He was the author of two books. One was his thesis at Harvard University, which was entitled, Why England Slept. The other was The Profiles of Courage, in which won him the Pulitzer Prize. He was the captain of a PT boat in World War II. He was decorated for his heroic rescue of the crew of his PT-109 after it was sunk. He was sunk and he was nominated by the presidency by Lyndon B. Johnson. It was his running mate in 1960. His platform was formed for this statement, we stand today on the edge of a new frontier. You may remember that man to be JFK, John Fitzgerald Kennedy. He was the 35th president of the United States. He was 43 years old when he became president, making him one of the youngest presidents of all time. While traveling through Dallas, Texas, November the 22nd, 1963, he was assassinated. You know, I wonder if he woke up that morning and he thought, you know what, I'm going to die today. I have an idea. He didn't think that. I wonder if Marilyn Monroe wondered when she woke up the morning of her passing and she thought to herself, you know what, I'm going to die today. I don't know really any people really in this world who say to themselves, today is going to be my day to die unless they take their own lives. What I'm saying to you today, friend, is you don't know when you're going to leave this world. I don't know when I'm going to leave this world. But the only way that you can be sure to be safe when you do leave is to be in Christ. The Bible says in Ephesians 1:3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Are you in Christ today? If you're outside of Christ, friend, you can't have spiritual blessings because all spiritual blessings are in Christ. You think about this, if you move down in Ephesians chapter 1 to verse 7, he says, in whom, that is in Christ, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So if I'm outside of Christ, I don't have the forgiveness of sins. I don't have the riches of his grace. You see, today, people that are blessed when they die are those who die in Christ. Blessed are they who die in the Lord. In Ephesians 1:11, he continues the same idea and he said, in whom, that is in Christ, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things according to his own will. So you think about this, friend. If I am not in him, then what blessing should I say that I should receive on that day? Friend, I won't receive any. In fact, it will be even worse. Not only will I not receive a blessing, but I will be condemned for all eternity if I'm not in Christ. You know, Paul wrote to Timothy, a young preacher, and he said, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. A lot of people look at that and they just say, well, of course, salvation is in Christ. I mean, yeah, you have to go to Christ for salvation. But what they're not seeing is, what Paul is telling him is, salvation is in Christ, in the body of Christ. It's not outside of the body of Christ. Friend, if you're outside of the Lord's church, you cannot go to heaven. Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Matthew 16:18. If I want to be protected from the gates of hell, then I have to be in the church where he said they will not prevail against it. You've got to be in Christ, friend. And I beg and plead with you today to make sure that you're not just a part of any church, but the church of the Bible. So today, I want to move on and talk about the peace. He said, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord, that they may rest from their labors. I'm reminded of a boy, he asked his friend, he said, what would you give me if I climbed Mount Everest? His friend thought for a minute and he said, well, I think I would give you a push. Well, you got to watch out for some people, you know, you can't trust everybody. And think about this, friend. If you have a great accomplishment, such as obeying the gospel, some people would want to tear you down for that. But God, He wants nothing more than to give you peace. I mean, you think about all the things that God did so that you could rest for eternity. I mean, He had this whole huge plan to send His Son, and the Bible says the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world, Revelation 13, 8. So He had this plan from the foundation of the world to save your soul. That ought to give you peace. You know, I think about this passage. It says in the book of Jeremiah, from the least of them, even unto the greatest of them, everyone is given to covetousness, and the prophet, even to the priest, everyone deals falsely. They have healed also the hurt of the daughter of my people, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. You think about that. I mean, that's what we're talking about today. These false prophets were preaching peace, but God said, no, you're going to go into captivity for 70 years. And the false prophets, they're saying, oh, God wouldn't do that. Oh, He loves you. God wouldn't send you into captivity for 70 years. And Jeremiah's telling these people, no, God told you to repent. Because if you don't, you're not going to have peace. And the false prophets, that's what they're doing. They're prophesying, oh, yeah, there's lots of peace. But Jeremiah said, there is none. In fact, he told them why. He said, were they ashamed when they committed abomination? They were not at all ashamed, and neither could they blush. Therefore they shall fall among them that fall, and at the time that I visit them, saith the Lord, they shall be cast down. Now notice, thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the good paths, wherein is the good ways, and you shall find rest for your souls. But you know what they said in the next verse? We will not walk therein. Also, I set watchmen, saying, hearken to the voice of the trumpet. But they said, we will not hearken. They didn't want the peace that God was offering. They didn't want the rest that God was offering. God said, you find the good way where you'll find rest for your soul. And they said, no, we don't want that kind of rest. Friend, do you want God's rest today? You have to go to the good way. Seek the old paths. Go straight to the Bible. Say, Lord, what do I need to do to go to heaven? The Bible says in Philippians chapter 4 that when you do that, the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Number 5, I want to finish with this point. Not only do we see the patience of the saints and the promise of the saints and the peace of the saints, but you think about this, the performance of the saints. Because He said, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord, from henceforth yea saith the Spirit, that they may rest, notice, from their labors. They will rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. I want to ask you, what have you done? I've got to ask myself, what have I done for the Lord's service? You know, the Bible teaches that we will be judged by our works. A lot of people say, oh, there's nothing you can do to work your way to heaven. Well, there is. You've got to obey the commands of God. I can't work my own work. I can't just go to the nursing home and give to charities and do all these great things. No, but I do have to obey the commands of God. That's what the Bible's talking about when it says, I am judged by my works. You know, an African impala can jump up to 10 feet high and jump as far as 20 feet in length. I mean, you think about that. That's amazing how high and how far that animal can jump. But the weird thing about this animal is you can put up a 3-foot fence and that animal will never jump over that fence. You think, well, why? Because he can jump clear over the fence. I mean, he can jump 10 feet high and 20 feet in length. Surely he would jump over the fence. The African impala will not jump somewhere that he cannot see. So he cannot see over the 3-foot fence, and therefore he will never jump over it because he cannot see over it. A lot of people in this world are doing the same thing with their lives. They will not trust someone that they do not see, who is God. The Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Do you have faith enough to practice what you do not see? We read about God in the Bible. We trust Him. We see the evidence of God in the world today, and we see the evidence that the Bible is from God, and we obey His commands. We have to perform it, friend. We have to do it by faith. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12, and I want you to think soberly about this word, being judged by our works. Revelation 20, 12, John wrote, and he said, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, the books of the Bible. And another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Now, does the Bible say that you're judged by your works, or does it not? Friend, it just did. In fact, John said God is going to compare the 66 books of the Bible to the book of life, and he's going to say, all right, did you obey this or did you not? Did you obey this or did you not? The dead are judged according to their works. He continues and he said, the sea gave up the dead which were in them. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to their works. That's the second time he mentioned that in that passage. He continues and he said, death and hell were cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, and whosoever was not found written in the Lamb's book of life was cast into the lake of fire. I want to ask you, friend, are you in the Lamb's book of life today? When you die, could you say, I am dying in the Lord, in the body of Christ, the church that's found in the Bible? Not some denomination that was established by some man, but by the Lord who built His church. And He said, upon this rock, I will build my church, Matthew 16, 18. Are you a part of that body today? I hope to conclude this lesson with this thought, friend. How do you enter that body? The religious world is so diverse on what to do to be saved. But the Bible says in Ephesians 5, 23 that Christ is the Savior of the body. So I've got to find out, how do I get into that body? And you come to Acts chapter 2, which is the first day of the church. They said the same thing you're asking. In verse 37 of Acts 2, they said, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter told them. But I want you to notice what he did not tell them. He did not tell them to ask Jesus to come into your heart and be your personal Savior. No. They already believed in Jesus. That's why they said, what do we need to do? He also did not tell them to say a sinner's prayer, because to be truthful about it, you can never find a sinner's prayer at all in the Bible. You know, that doctrine is only about 100 years old. That's not something that came from the first century. Billy Graham is the one who made it popular in 1935. So that's a new doctrine. You know, that's a foreign doctrine to the Bible. You can't find the sinner's prayer in the Bible. So the question is, what did he tell them to do when they asked, what do we need to do? He told them in verse 38 of Acts 2, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. In verse 41, they gladly received his word. They were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. They were added to something when they were baptized. What were they added to? Well, the Bible tells us in verse 47, the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. You see, Acts 2 is the place where the church began, and he told them, if you want to be saved, you've got to be in the church. Verse 47. They gladly received it. They were baptized into it, verse 41. And in verse 38, he said, you've got to do something before. You've got to repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins. That tells me everything put together. I contact the blood in the body of Christ. And the only way to do that is to repent and be baptized into it. I pray that you'll obey the gospel, friend, that you will die in the Lord to rest with God for all eternity. May God bless you. Until next time. Thanks for viewing.